Good morning, everyone. And I want to start my lecture by thanking Dr. Umakant Mishra for asking me to deliver the lecture on the topic Traces of Epidemics on Human Bones, a Paleopathological Approach. I'm thankful to all of you who are there on the screen, on the net, who are going to listen to my talk. I'm thankful for them also. And I will start with my topic, saying what exactly what I'm going to cover in this presentation. It is like historicity of epidemics, the paleopathology and its methods and limitations, because that is the tool which we used to understand the health and disease of bygone populations, and a few case studies of on infection disease, and understanding social cultural context, because any disease or any kind of different pathology cannot be understood without considering the social as well as cultural and as well as the economical background. So this is very important to understand the pathology, to interpret the pathology, why particular disease is prevalent in particular time or particular society or particular strata of the society. So these are the things needs to be understood. So when we talk about the epidemic spread, when we call it as an epidemic, so first these are like first the human population should get exposure to different pathogens, which can be which can lead to the infection, and then that infection is transmission or transmitted to the different population or different people, and when that goes to the next level, we call it as an epidemic spread or epidemics, like the people, the large number of people are getting infected by one particular pathology or disease or different diseases. So when we talk about the history of pandemics or epidemics, we have a known history of occurrence of plague, and then you have Black Death, plague, different types of plagues, or smallpox, then smallpox and other great plagues. These are the time frames when we are getting the pandemic evidences or the epidemic evidences. As you can see here, it is around this 165 to 180 AD. You have this 5 million people died because of the plague, and these are like when we call as epidemics is epi is upon or a plus demos is people or population. So demos are the upon the population, so disease spreading upon the population, and pandemic is the epidemic that spread over the multiple countries or continents. So it doesn't have any geographical boundary or any particular boundary where it cannot be reached, like as you can see today's COVID-19, where you are having the entire world facing this big problem. So disease like spread, contagious, and these are like comes under the pandemic or epidemics. So when we talk about from the historical point of view, this paper was published in 2019, where they have said that there is a frequent appearance of infection disease in archaeological record, and they have taken this molecular detection of the viapestis, like basically the plague, and then you are having this coinciding with the Neolithic or Bronze Age population, where the agriculture intensification started, where the domestication of plants and animals were already done, and you have different plagues, the evidences of plagues you are having. Then the so these are the where you are getting the exposure to different types of diseases since 5000 BC. So when we talk about the intensification of agriculture or beginning of agriculture, you are having the early Holocene period, which is we have this increase in this form. And then you have middle Holocene, where you are having different centers where the agriculture intensification started, like India has rice and millet. Then you have China with millet, rice, soybean, and others. So different places at different time frame, like around 12,000 to 812 2000 years before present, you are having this crescent and coming to the around 8,000 to 4,000. So this is the time which is very crucial for our point of view, because we are having the civilization, we call it as an Indus civilization, or this comes in this particular time bracket, like Middle Holocene. So you are having different areas or regions with the domestication of different plants. When we think about the animals timing, so taming or domestication of the animals, you see here around 8,000 BP, you are having humped cow domestication. Then before that, you are having cat, and then different animals are domesticated. So this shows the interaction between the man and animal increase throughout the history, since when we talk about the early Stone Age places. So when we see this, so this is called as zoonotic disease. So you can see that the changes in the interaction between the humans and animals changes from time. Like you are having the 6 million years ago, you are having just a wild fauna, and then before, after that, you are having the dog domestication as a companion, and then you have a livestock around 12,000 BP, so like cows and everything, and then later on you are having this rats and other which are domesticated. So basically, zoonotic diseases are from reservoir, you are getting infection to the humans, and from humans you are getting to the different humans as well. So these are the ways to airborne, like transmission of viruses. Then you have vectors, like transmission infected agents from animals, and the close proximity towards to with the animals. Like you can see in today's also villages, you have to keep the livestock near to you to protect them or to keep watch on them. So it's like from there you are getting either by airborne, or you are eating, consuming their milk, or consuming meat, and then these are or bites from infected animals. So these are the ways from where we are getting infected from the animals. So these comes under the zoonotic diseases. So these are different types of diseases which comes from, like plague, like Yersinia pestis, that comes from the rats and the fleas. Then flea blight is the scratches or bites from infected cats. So these are the ways how the infections are from the animals comes to humans. So you are having the rabies and yellow fever. Then you are having bovine tuberculosis, which comes from basically from the cattle. And you, if you drink unpasteurized milk, exposure to so of exposure to the tuberculosis animal, then you have a direct contact, indirect contact. Then mosquitoes are the major problem with the from the mosquitoes, we are getting a lot of diseases. So this coincides with the population growth as well. As you can see in this particular graph, you can see that around agriculture revolution, around 10,000 BP, you are having the agriculture revolution, agriculture, and again it is combining with the population growth. So steadily the population growth is expanding, and then around 2000, like you are having the very big large shift from the population growth, and it is exponentially is increasing. So you are, because of different like metal working or irrigation plowing, or these are the major areas what we consider in the archaeological context, like agriculture revolution, metal working, irrigation and plowing. Then this comes under the industrial area where the population is boomed. So this again, as I told you to the second, third slide, like it is again coinciding with the with the population, with the infection growth rate. So when the population is increasing, at the same time the growth of infection diseases are also increasing. We are having malaria, tuberculosis, smallpox, leprosy, cholera, these kind of diseases coming into the human population through the with the zoonotic diseases, as well as the population growth. Because if you are staying very close proximity with each other, then there is every chance of you are getting infection disease. So this is how you can trace back. Just to go briefly to how what kind of evidences we can get from the archaeological population, like these are the different types of burials. Here you can see this is a four-leg jar from Inamgaon. This is exposed twin burial, twin urn burial from Inamgaon. Then this is from the disturbed burial. So you can see the preservation of bones is very vital to understand the pathology or any kind of observation. All our understanding or our observations are depend completely solely upon the bones and its conditions. If the bones conditions are very good, then we can identify the pathologies, or if we can able to get more information of the about those population or that individual, we can see very well. But if the preservation of the bones are not very well, so we are stuck up with a very minimum amount of data. So here you can see twin burials from Inamgaon. This is a very interesting. Here there are three individuals buried in one pit. So probably we can say that why this particular, because these two are subadults, one is adult. So probably some kind of infection may have led to their death. That's why they got buried together. And this is one more burial from Balathal. Then these are the extended adult burials, Harappa and then Fermana. Then these are the deep Lothal. You are having double burial. Then you are Grakigadi, very properly preserved burials from the Harappan context. With that, we have these literary resources like Rigveda, Atharvaved, Charaka Samhita, or Shushruta Samhita, which is coinciding culturally with maybe agro-pastoral communities, maybe around 2000 BCE. That is the usual date cited by many scholars of Rigveda. So they are like having the references of leprosy, then jaundice, tuberculosis. Atharvaveda again talks about leprosy, jaundice, tuberculosis, fever, cough, cold, paralysis, and other things. Then other later. So you can see that there are a lot of diseases are mentioned in these texts. Probably this indicates that these diseases were very much not common, but they're very much present in during those times. Like you are having the cholera also in some of our plague in the Shushruta Samhita as well. So these are the things you need to understand, not only this archaeological bones samples, but archaeology as well as these kind of literary resources where you are kind of coinciding or coinciding with the archaeological settings. So when we talk about paleopathology, it's essentially it is defined as a studies of ancient sufferings or ancient diseases, and it is like discipline that aims to trace the origin, evolution, and history of disease over the long periods of time. It's like from Neolithic, Chalcolithic, or from the so long period of time, how we are able to trace the evolution of pathology. The objective of paleopathology research includes diagnosis of specific disease in archaeological remains, analysis of those impact of various diseases on human population, and clarification of evolutionary interactions between humans and disease, how they were interacting with each other. So that is also one of the aim of paleopathologists when they are doing skeletons. So there are like what type of lesions it is, or diagnosis. Main first is diagnosis. What is a normal bone and what is taphonomically changed bone, or what is exactly pathology. So you need to differentiate between these, and then you try to identify which one is the pathological bone. How the lesion is formed, what is the nature of bone changes, what methods of diagnosis, like why you are calling such a pathology in such describing such a pathology in such a manner. So you need to understand the nature of bone changes in of related to that pathology. And why this lesion is formed, why there is a tuberculosis, or why there is a leprosy, or why there is a smallpox or cholera. So why is very important, because it gives you have to answer that from the cultural point of view, cultural context of view, social context of it, and the entire society is kind of responsible to have that kind of a pathology on the on humans. It's not just pathology, but how it is interacting. So potential areas of research where all people can actually, anthropologists can contribute in pathology. So methods like microscopy like histology, scanning electron microscopy, then X-ray or CT scan, bones chemistry like trace element analysis or stable isotope analysis. These are the important ways to get into details of the pathology. Because what generally we do is we see the bone and we try to see what is abnormal with it, but why, how much abnormal it is. So you need to go for X-ray or CT scan, all those things to get better understanding of the bone changes. So the problem with this is there's a cost involvement and the facilities, whether both things should be available to the anthropologist. DNA sequencing is one of the very good tool, but it all depends on the survival of DNA, and there is always a problem of contamination. It is always contaminated, or it is very difficult to get the DNA. And it is not just the DNA of the individual, but the DNA of the pathogen. The survival of the DNA or molecular evidence of the pathogen is very crucial. So other resources, like I told you about literature, like Atharvaveda or Rigveda or any other Ayurveda, when we are talking about later societies, and epigraphy, iconography. Many times in the temples you have seen some disfigured icons, or the human figurine. So obviously there's some inferences can be made from that sculpture, on drawings or epigraphic evidences, like the somebody has donated this much amount for this person to get cured or something like that. So if these kind of things can be correlated with the archaeological findings. The problem with the diagnosis of on the skeletons is the study is only restricted largely to those diseases which are affecting the skeletons. So it has to be prolonged sickness. It cannot be like immediate. In certain cases, like cut marks or other things, you can get the direct evidences or immediate problem of the bone. But if you want to see any infections on the bone, it has to be documented on bone, because bone is the last element to get affected by the any kind of disease. So bone produce, and the bone has very limited ways to showing the any kind of diseases, like porosity or periosteosis infection, or some kind of a there are two major methods, like osteoblast and osteoclast. So basically the cells destruction and cell formation. So there is a this kind of a imbalance between these two can create a different texture on the bone, and but that is again a very limited if you compare to any other parts of the body. And determine the cause of the death is always a difficult task. You cannot at na around 99% you cannot say about the cause of the death. Maybe few percentage you are able to say. And the population studied are dead and may not representative of the living group. As I was telling, like Harappan, in the Harappan civilization or Harappan context, like you are having like Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, or any big cities, you would name it, like Fermanagh, Rakhigarhi, or anything. So if you get any these kind of large cities, there must be more than 10,000, 50,000 people living at that particular place at one particular time. But when you get the bones about, say, 200 specimens or 200 individuals from those graveyard, so they are not a complete representation of population. They are the fragment of the population is represented in the graves or the in the cemetery. So you are having very partial what you can say views about the population. So it is very fragmented. So you need to piece together the these fragments and try to understand the population in general. So that is a main problem with the diagnosing about and understanding. It's not just the diagnosing, it's about the understanding of the pathological lesions. For the study purpose, we generally divide our pathological lesions in different forms or different types, basically, like congenital, like from the birth defects, then infection disease, traumatic lesions, joint disease, metabolic disease, stress factors, neoplastic or new bone formation, dental disease. These comes under the different these are mainly the main headings for under which we study the skeletal pathology. For our purpose, we are just doing the infection disease and the metabolic disease. So when we talk about the infection disease, which are there of importance, because infection, what we are going through is a epidemics is basically the infection. It is very commonly found in archaeological context and very difficult to distinguish between the various infection disorders. So we get infected by many viruses or bacteria, but it's very difficult to get that information from the archaeology. So like abnormal bone formation, abnormal bone destruction, or abnormal size and abnormal shapes. These are the main criteria where we try to understand the infection. There are two types of infection mainly. One is non-specific infection, where we are not able to identify the which infection led to this kind of bone destruction. And there is something called a specific infection, where we are very sure that this infection is led by this particular pathology or this bacteria or this virus, like leprosy, tuberculosis, treponemal infection. These are the things where we are learning. So virus, we need to know about what is virus and bacteria, because COVID-19 is a virus, not a bacterial infection. So basically, viruses are non-living organisms and bacteria are living organism. Viruses only grow and reproduce inside the host. And viruses are sub microscopic. Bacteria is giant in comparison to viruses. Sorry, compared to the viruses. So these are the main differences between the viruses versus bacteria. So when we see the infection disease in the which leads to epidemics, so infections by viruses are influenza, hepatitis B, yellow fever, smallpox, meningitis. That one, and the infection caused by bacteria are cholera, plague, tuberculosis, leprosy, malaria. These are comes under the bacterial infection, which leads to the epidemics. All these leads to the epidemics because you cannot control these viruses or these bacteria. So it spreads and becomes into epidemics or pandemics. Non-specific infections looks like this, in the way, like you can see, there is an active, the bone is swelled here. I'm sorry, I'm not able to put the normal bone how it looks and then compare the this one, but this is definitely not normal bone. This is swelling and osteoporosis. You can see here there is a porosity in the femoral or the thigh bone here, and this is a radius and ulna, these bones of a infant. So you can see it's a very porous bone, and the radius is completely disfigured. And this is maybe 1 month old child. This is 1 month old infant. So this is from the Nagaland. So we identify this kind of infection, and we are still coming into any conclusion why this such a grave pathologies there on this particular infant. Then there are specific infection like trypanosomal infection. Trypanosomal infection, like you can see, very porous. As you can see, this porosity is, you need to create your own vision how when you say that this porosity looks different than this porosity. But here again, you are having the this is a tibia and this is a fibula, and you can see the very much destruction of the upper table of the bone. And this is a Agripalis skull where the trypanosomal infection. So trypanosomal infection like syphilis, pinta, yaws, these are comes under the syphilic infection. These are basically sexually transmitted diseases. So this can also be seen. So there are many theories how it spread throughout the world. Once is like it came with the Columbus and got no new world. From old world it got introduced to the new world, and some says that it was already there in the new world, and they got different ways to the earth. So it spread to the with the Columbus voyage, so 1495. So this is how the trypanosomal infection. There are a lot of theories about this spread. So this is one more very destructive face of a trypanosomal infection, and you can see the complete destruction of the perforating lesions of the cheekbone. Basically, zygomatic bone means cheekbones, and then you have caries sicca. This is called as a caries sicca here. So this one, and you are thickening of the cortex of the bone. Then the active cavitating or the active periosteosis you can see on the femur. So these all indicates that these particular individual was having the trypanosomal infection. Then this is a CT scan of the same skull, and this is how the infection looks when there is a facial infections are involved here. So the entire face is kind of disfigured or very badly it is showing these kind of features. So this is just to show you. So this is how you can identify different lesions, its gravity and other things. So with the CT scan, this is the X-ray of the individual. So you can see the thinning of this cortical bone. Cortical bone is thin down and very light bone it is, and you are having this light color bone density is very less. So these are the things you can identify in the skeletons, and can tell you many more things about the bones if you are not able to tell it from the surface observation. This is one called as a trypanosomal infection or congenital syphilis. This is child gets infected within the womb. So they are known as a mulberry molars, or they known the moon's molars or incisor, different types of. So these are the when the child is inside the womb, the teeth are forming, and during that time you are having these kind of. So these are the very typical lesions which tells you about the congenital syphilis, which is really interesting. We don't have these kind of syphilis. I haven't seen it on some many on till now on skeletons, but this is very interesting, which can tell you the transmission of disease from mother to child. Then these are the metabolic disease, which are not exactly, this is just the disturbances of the normal forming cells get disturbed during the developmental period. And then you can see those developmental disturbances in bone or teeth. And then after the child, after it's the individual or child is recovered, again the normal cell grows. This is the infection. Okay, so we were talking about this. So this is a metabolic disease, which is about the disturbances cells of the normal growth rate or normal growth development of the disease. Normal growth disturbances lines, which can be identified in the in the dentition, like these are called as enamel hypoplasia, linear enamel hypoplasia, and this is basically linear enamel hypoplasia, and this is Harris lines, which are the growth disturbances lines or growth arrested lines, where the normal cell growth is stopped, and then after some time you are having the new development of the cells. So you can say that this is a growth arrested line. So this is a indirect evidence of infection or disease. This is not a direct evidence, where you can see they are the infection and malnourishment, they are symbiotically related to each other, which I can tell you, I will tell you later. This is the active periostosis infection on the infant of mandible, and this comes under the scurvy, or you can say the vitamin C deficiency. So vitamin C deficiency, and this is also indication of some kind of infection to some kind of a malnourishment to this particular child. This is one more interesting fact I want to tell you here. This is a, as I told you, this is a complete exposed infant burial from Nevasa, and you can see this is the active periostosis here on the temporal bone, and this is active periostosis bone on the periostosis on the bone. So as you can see here, in the infant category, around 57% of the children are dying before even crossing 1 year of their age. So it shows that high infant mortality rate was there in when we are talking about the Chalcolithic level or early agropastoral societies. So this is the time when you are having the introduction of new food, like the weaning age. We call it as a weaning age, like the child is shifted, or the infant is shifted from the mother's milk to the solid food. So when that change happens, you are having the exposure to the different infection because of the food, the pattern of food changes. So this can be very good indicator to having the infection or infection rates high on the higher side in during the first year of their age. So this is also a very interesting example for you to discuss here. So this is the iron deficiency anemia. This is iron deficiency anemia. Earlier it is used to call as iron deficiency anemia, or and which has a active porosity on the crania, and this is a orbital Erkleba orbitalia, where you are having the porosity on the roof of your orbit or roof of your eyes. So this was earlier considered to be the iron deficiency, related to the iron deficiency, but later on it was said that it is related to sickle cell anemia or sickle cell pathology. So this is, I will tell you why I'm putting this. This is a one interesting paper which was published in 2015, related to the malarial infection, how we can identify malaria in a skeletal evidence. Because so this is like called as a humeral fibra and femoral fibra. Basically, it's a upper arm porosity here, and the porosity of the femur here. So, and the porosity of the vertebral column here, and the spinal porosity. So these are, according to the author, these are the very good indicators for identifying malarial infection on the human skeleton. So earlier it was not possible, but now we can at least try to identify the infection, malarial infection from the skeletons. So why this is important? But because the malaria, the kind of malaria basically is from mosquito born. So the mosquitoes is more prevalent. The area of mosquito is a tropical region, so in which the India is a part of that tropical region. So our region is infect having epidemics, malarial epidemic epidemic since long time, and many people die because of the malarial infection. So to fight these kind of malarial infection, the body has its own defense system, which comes under the sickle cell anemia, sickle cell disease, or thalassemia. So these are the different ways where we can identify the sickle cell anemia from the skeleton. So like thinning of the diploid, or the thinning of the outer table of skull, or cerebroorbitalia, or these kind of places can we can able to identify the sickle cell anemia, which indirectly tell us that if the population was suffering from the sickle cell anemia or thalassemia, then probably this population was suffering from the malaria. So it has a symbiotic relationship, which with each other. One does not exist if the other is not there. So that is a way we can identify the malaria in the Harappan. That this is what the paper tried to identify, the malarial infection in the Harappan, during the Harappan population. Because Harappans, again, you are having this tropical region, and then you are having the waterborne diseases might be prevalent and was prevalent. Today also we are having waterborne diseases. So obviously these are the cultural conducive environment for the malarial infection. So obviously it was possible to get that infection in during the Harappan time. So this is a very interesting way to look at the pathology also. Then we try to identify the tuberculosis from the Indus civilization, and where we found that these kind of porous bone surfaces, and you are having the thickening and twisting of the bone ulna here, and the infection on the clavicle and the fibular bone. So these are the things where we can identify the tuberculosis from the skeleton. So this was, we consider that at the end of the Indus civilization, maybe because end of civilization means it was a drought, it was considered one of the main reason is the drought. So there is no water, and whatever water is present, then it might have problem with the sanitation, unhygienic conditions, and other things. So slowly this population spread through different ways, and slowly the cities came down and became a small towns. So this is maybe one of the reason, like the infections or diseases was prominently seen in this later Harappan context. So the tuberculosis is like woven bone, as you can see here, and then you are having the laminar bone formation. Then these kind of bone changes or grooves and enlargement and rough surfaces. Then you are having this porous lesions on the vertebral column. So this is the thing where we can identify it's an indication of tuberculosis. And they identified tuberculosis case from one Egyptian mummies, and this is how the spinal tuberculosis looks like. It is like curved vertebral body, and this is so all this shows this mummy, the tuberculosis from the mummy, it shows that the tuberculosis was very much prevalent in the earlier ancient times. So this is how we can identify the history of tuberculosis from archaeological context. We try to identify the skeletal evidence of leprosy from India, and we found in Balathal. And as you can see, this paper was cited by many people, one of the ancient leprosy cases. So you can see all the extremities, like this nasospine or frontal bone here or here. These are all damaged, or these are all kind of walled off. So these kind of things, or the here you can see the mandible where lost its a grip. The bones has receded down. So these are the cases we can identify from the skeletal, and we can see leprosy. All the extremities of your body is affected by the leprosy. So this is very interesting case what we identify, and it is this is again there is one more point is we do not find many cases or many individuals with leprosy in archaeological population because the way the leprosy looks, it's very scary to look at the patients having suffering from the leprosy. So people were trying to confine them at one particular area or one particular time place, so where the infection cannot be spread to the other pop others within the village or within the population. So maybe that is the reason why we do not get any patients or we do not get any evidence of leprosy from the ancient times in India. This is very interesting paper which was published in 2018, which tells you about the genetic evidences of hepatitis B from ancient time, and they took DNA samples from five individuals, and the earliest date they got for the this hepatitis B was around 7,000 years, and which is coinciding again with the Neolithic population, which means the domestication of plants, domestication of animals were in a very so it's combining together with that, and the phylogenetic network, which shows that they are different than what today's the makeup of genetic makeup of the hepatitis B, as maybe they are changing according the way we have changed or adjusted or modified ourselves with the different viruses, bacteria, and environment. Similar things were happening are happening with the bacteria as well as viruses. So these are the very interesting paper to look at. So there is this paper is very much available in the net. Another evidence of this is the why pestis was common in Eurasia in during the Bronze Age, and around 6,000 years they have found this particular ancestor of plague during this in Russia. So this is very interesting paper. Like around 3000 BC to 800 BC, they are finding many cases. These like six individuals they identified, and this paper was published in 2015. And so you are having the plague, the evidence of plague, very old, which is going much before than what it was expected, and which is coinciding again with the intensification of the agriculture activity. So this is also a genetic evidences. Which plays very important role to identify the history of epidemics overall. When I talk about in general from the archaeological context, we see that when the change in subsistence pattern, when we talk hunting gathering to agriculture means intensification of agriculture, population growth, population expansion with domestication of animals and animals all comes together, which results into the change in settlement pattern and change in food habits. So change in settlement pattern, obviously, once the population growth is there, you have to feed the people, like dependent population, like children and old age. So you have to intensify the products from the limited land, and then you have to do trade intensification, you have to exploit new areas, new resources. And when you have change in food habits, obviously you will shift from the good quality food, nutritious food, to the carbohydrate based bad quality of food, or poor quality, not bad, poor quality of the food, which leads to again to malnourishment. And malnourishment and infection diseases are kind of symbiotic relationship. If you are having infection, whatever you eat, what type of food you eat, the food is not digested or the elements are not restored in your body. And if you are malnourished or undernourished, you are very much exposed to the infection disease. So it plays like it reflects in your age, your sex, and genetic susceptibility. So younger people or young children are more susceptible to the infection. And again, the sex related thing means the females, whether how the female are being treated within the society, whether they are given food, proper food, or water, proper growth in the society, how the society is seeing their gender and how they are treating the gender. So that also, so all this results into the growth disturbances, and finally it ends up to the mortality rate. So you are having high mortality rate in the population expansion, and for when you are having the agriculture based economy. So this is again different way to look at it, like the bodies of plague victims. So this is just another, like what is we call it today as a quarantine. Quarantine has the word come from Italy. It is called, mean the quarantagirone, which means 40 days. So the people in the 1340s, when they were coming from the voyages, they were kept, those people, in the quarantine, or the in the area where they should not enter the into the cities. So after 40 days, who were alive, they used to come, and who were used to, who the only lucky ones were used to leave, but rest of them used to die in that quarantine facilities. So this is the name has come from the Italy. So these are the, as I was telling you, so the confining the these kind of infections, trying to confine them at one particular time, it's been happening since long time. As you can see here, there is a the these are two B persons, they are shown drawn in the picture, where they are infected with the leprosy. So they are confined, they have been chained, and there are, so these are like just to keep them at one place so that they cannot enter the society, they cannot infect any other people, any other person within the society. So like cholera hospital or plague hospital, these are the things, the facilities which are quarantine facilities were created since long time, when the epidemics were prevalent within the society. Today, as you see in COVID-19 cases, we are having quarantine facilities where we are trying to put the infected people for away from the society, and trying to treat them. So because we are fearing that they might infect others also. So that this is a quarantine facilities were created since long. Coming back to the archaeological setting, as you can see, this is the Daimabad, the plan of houses. These are the pits where you can see these places are very much crowded in comparison. So see these kind of crowded dwellings, it leads to the infection, spread of infection very fast. So if you are staying in one close proximity, you are prone to have a lot of infection, and if some person is infected, then it spreads very easily to other person. So this is how, as you can see in this particular slide, you can see that people are living in a very close knit houses, and they are using their most of the time outside of houses. So the courtyard becomes, or the area the becomes very important, and most of the activities is done in the there is a proximity of animals very close to it, and then you are having the even it's rainy, it becomes more difficult because you cannot use those areas. So you are confining yourself in the small huts and very crowded conditions, and here the social place thing. So if we are staying very close to each other, which is very harmful for the from the point of view infection. As today's case, we are seeing that the slum areas, or the places where people are in a crowded condition, they are more infected in comparison with the people who are living in a better habitat. So the economy also plays very important role, what kind of resources you are getting. So if you are poor, you are about you are living in a very shanty houses, very close, very crowded places, and socially also, social, economic, and culturally, that reflects the kind of infection you are exposed to. When we talk about the animals. So like this kind of animal act, the agriculture activities, and the shepherds, they literally stay with the animals. So they are exposed to a lot of dust, lot of the viruses and bacteria coming from these animals, and the animals, the agriculture activities. So you are staying in the water for a long period of time, and then from through waterborne diseases are introduced to human population. So when there is a drought or when there is a water scarcity, mainly it is happens in most of the time in India. So you have to survive in whatever water available for you, like murky, muddy, or any dirty water. So the cholera or diarrhea, these kind of diseases are very rampant in these particular areas because of the introduction of the bacteria and viruses through water. And you can see the some of the ladies has to go like kilometers to bring the small quantity of water. So again, they are very much the water scarcity can be seen very prominently seen in Indian context. So these are the very grave issues when we are dealing with the infection. The river or the any pond area plays a very important role about the waterborne diseases. So in this, you can see many people are using this water body for different. Somebody's washing clothes, somebody's taking bath, somebody's spitting. These are the things. So it happens. So you are actually the dirty water is entering to your system through these kind of common resources. So these kind of like there the animal is being washed, the cow, cattle is being washed, she's cleaning her clothes, or here also same thing. And again you are using. So these are the things are very what very good for the spreading of infection, a good source of diseases. So these things needs to be understood, not just the identification of the pathology on the bone. Coming back to the second last slide, so population growth and technology has a very much as I was telling you, you can now understood, like it changes the entire system of particular area. So when you see that regional environmental changes, like landscape by level, you are seeing the increasing city, peri-urban culture, settlement population size is increased. You are having suburban, peri-urban encroachment into the wilderness settlement. It's coming very long distance transport, and so you are having biotic collapses are happening. Then hyperabundance of potential and actual vectors in the reservoir species. So there are like mosquitoes, fleas, and other places. They are bringing the different kind of bacteria. So wild fauna getting introduced into the domestic domain, domestic fauna getting into the wild. So you are very close to even the animals, also wild as well as the domesticated. Then human encroachment or increasing human wildlife contacts is much more. Then while doing agriculture intensification, you are diverting the water. Irrigation is happening. You are changing the water system. You are changing the water course. You are contaminating the water. So you are having the accumulation of chemicals, different kinds of chemicals in the water resources, which change all these landscapes level. It changes this level, this changes, which results into the natural community level, like human ecosystem and natural ecosystem. There is no balance at all. So you have the vector reservoir and wildlife domestications transport. Then so this results into the population level, like emergence of the process of host parasite biology, hosting switching host novelty, and breaching pathogens persistence thresholds, and transmission amplification and genetic exchange. So basically, it's talking about the host population pathogen dynamics, like it's changing with the human population. It is getting more infection, more we are getting exposure to the from bats. They say that the new death from bats, like 334 pathogens are introduced to the human population. So it is how the things are happening. So it which all this results into the mortality.